Good morning and welcome to this service. Of course, we want to welcome everyone, our regular members and visitors alike. If you are visiting with us, we certainly want you to feel welcome. We're glad that you're here. And if you are visiting this morning, we would appreciate it if you would look in the songbook rack in front of you and get one of those visitor's cards and fill that out. You may leave that on the seat that we might have a record of your visit with us this morning. We also want to welcome those who are worshiping with us today remotely. Our services after this service this morning, we'll meet for classes at 10:15, and those classes will end at 11. Our Sunday evening service is at 6, and our Wednesday evening service is at 7 o'clock. And let me say this to our visitors. If you are visiting with us and you are not a member of the Church of Christ, and you have a question about anything that we do this morning in our worship or that we don't do that you might be curious about, you can see me after this service, and we will certainly try to get you a biblical answer to whatever questions that you might have. Have a lengthy sick list this morning.
37, Angry Words. It's number 37 in our hymn books.
Shall we pray together? Our Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for this day, the first day of the week, and for the privilege that we have to assemble together to worship and to serve Thee and give You the glory, the honor, and praise that You so richly deserve. And Father, above all things, are we thankful for Jesus Christ, our Savior and Your Son. And we know, Father, that He came to this earth, that He lived a perfect life. He set the example for us to follow. And He gave that life and died on that cross and shed His blood for our sins. And through His death, His burial, and His resurrection, and our obedience, Father, we can have at home with Thee in heaven. We're thankful, Father, that we can open our hearts and join our voices together in these songs of praises unto Thee, for the blessing that we have to go to Thee in prayer, for the privilege to meet around Thy table, and for the opportunity that we have to study from Thy Word. We thank Thee, Father, for Tony and for the ability that he has to teach Thy Word. And we pray that You'll be with him today and help each of us, Father, that we will learn more of Thy will. And we will continue to study your word and teach it to others, that through our example and our teaching, we can bring others unto thee. And we pray, Father, for those who are sick, those who are at home, nursing homes or hospitals. And if it be your will, Father, restore their health. And for those who have been sick and are recovering, Father, we rejoice with them and thank you for blessing them. And Father, we're so thankful for this country in which we live. We pray for the rulers of our nation and those of other nations, that they will always lead in a way that we can worship thee without the fear of mankind. Continue to be with us, Father, in this service, and help us to always be faithful to thee. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
This morning, as the invitation is extended following our lesson, we'll sing number 382 in the hymn books. It's Kneel at the Cross. And now as we prepare this morning to partake of the Lord's Supper, we're going to sing number 12, Alas, and Did My Savior Bleed?
Present who did not get a communion pack, if you would just raise your hand and our ushers will make sure that you get one. In order to prepare our minds for taking the Lord's Supper this morning, I'd like to read a portion of Mark chapter 15, beginning in verse 22. Then they brought him to the place called Golgotha, which is translated place of a skull. They tried to give him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him, and divided up his garments among themselves, casting lots for them to decide what each man should take. It was the third hour when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." They crucified two robbers with him, one on his right and one on his left. And the scripture was fulfilled, which says, "And he was numbered with transgressors." Those passing by were hurling abuses at him, wagging their heads and saying, "Ha! You who are going to destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests also, along with the scribes, were mocking him among themselves, saying, "He saved others, he cannot save himself. Let this Christ, the King of Israel, now come down from the cross, so we may see and believe." Those who were crucified with him were also insulting him. When the sixth hour came, darkness fell over the whole land until the ninth hour. At that hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which is translated, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they began saying, "Behold, he's calling for Elijah." Someone ran and filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a reed, and gave him a drink, saying, "Let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down." And Jesus uttered a loud cry and breathed his last. And the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. When the centurion who was standing right in front of him saw the way he breathed his last, he said, "Truly this man was the Son of God." Would you pray with me? Our Father God, as we gather around this table to remember that great sacrifice that your Son made, we ask you to bless this bread, which we know represents his broken body on that cross. Father, I ask that everyone who partakes of this morning can take it in a worthy manner, taking their minds back to that great day when that great sacrifice was made for the sins of mankind. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Pray with me again. Father, as we continue to give thanks, let's ask you to bless this cup, which represents your Son's shed blood on that cross of Calvary. Father, we just pray and ask that we can always remember that blood means the cleansing of our sins, an opportunity to be with you one day when we leave this life. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Scripture reading this morning is taken from 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 6 through 8. "This punishment which was inflicted by the majority is sufficient for such a man, so that, on the contrary, you ought rather to forgive and comfort him, to perhaps such a one be swallowed up with too much sorrow. Therefore, I urge you to reaffirm your love for him."
It's good to see everyone here dry. I forgot to mention to Brother Joe that we may be having an ark building contest this afternoon if the rain continues to fall. No, seriously, it was a very heavy rain, and I hope everyone will be careful as you go home, and maybe the Lord will allow this rain to cause our crops to grow and that we will have a very fruitful year this year. Correcting. That this series of lessons is probably not going to be a very popular one, because none of us really enjoy someone correcting us and saying, "This is where you need to make changes in your life." However, as I am teaching the book of Proverbs, chapter 12, verse 1, the latter part of that verse says that he who hates correction is stupid. A person who refuses to allow himself to be corrected by God's word is showing how senseless he can really be. We ought to be open to allowing God's word to affect us in our choices, in the way we act, and in the way we worship. I've also mentioned that this will be a series of lessons. They will not be necessarily in the order in which the chapters are found in the books of 1st and 2nd Corinthians. I will choose various points that are made in those. And this morning, in order to introduce our lesson, I want to begin by asking you a question. Are you an extremist. And I can imagine the thought bubbles above your heads. Well, no, I'm not an extremist. I'm not the person who is the radical. And so I'll ask again, have you ever described yourself perhaps as the most conservative person within the congregation? Or perhaps maybe have you said, we're the most conservative congregation in the county? Have you ever left the impression that when it comes to being conservative, you are at the epitome of it? Well, let me offer you the other side of the coin. Have you ever described yourself as the most liberal? And when you think about that, you think of someone who is very generous and very giving and even able to accept things maybe that others might not. You know, in our world today, we are a nation full of extremists. It's very easy for people in the congregation to become extremists. But I'd like to direct your attention to two passages in the book of Deuteronomy. We're studying that on our Monday morning Bible class, and there's some passages there that I think are very helpful. Chapter 5 and verse 32. Therefore, you shall be careful to do as the Lord your God has commanded you. You shall not turn aside to the right hand or to the left. I remember having a class under Brother Roy Deaver. Brother Deaver, looking at the class, said, young men, you can run off the side of the road on the right hand or on the left. And you may sometimes want to overcorrect. You realize you've been going the wrong direction, and you turn so swiftly that you run off the side on the other. And he said, that has been a characteristic of many in our brotherhood. They have gone from one extreme to another extreme. Chapter 12, verse 32, whatever I command you, be careful to observe it. You shall not add to it nor take away from it. You don't change what God has given you. You don't make yourself more conservative than God or less conservative than God. You don't make yourself more liberal than God nor less liberal than God. Well, in our lesson this morning, we're going to observe that the Corinthians were extremists on a particular topic in both directions on the same issue. And you would say, how can that be? It's like a pendulum swings from one side to the other. And when you find someone who's in the wrong place, they almost sometimes go too far with it. Well, here's what we're going to do, as we did last week and as we will do in our future lessons. We'll begin, first of all, with understanding the problem and then to look at the prescription that God's Word has to offer. Let's begin with a problem. Let's open our Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 5. Let's look at verses 1 and 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 1 and 2. And Paul would write, it is actually reported that there is fornication among you, and such fornication as is not even named among the Gentiles. Then a man has his father's wife, and you are puffed up, and have not rather mourned that he who has done this deed might be taken away from among you. Now, there are several aspects that are involved in what we're going to discuss. The first one is sin. Sin, according to 1 John 3, verse 4, is a transgression of God's law, where a man violates what God has told him to do, and there is sin there. But there is also, in this context, rebuke. A man commits a sin, and when he does, God's word rebukes him. There is in this study repentance, where a man turns his heart, his mind, his life, and his actions back in the right direction Then number four, there is forgiveness once a person has repented and corrected those things. Now, Corinth has a sin problem. And I would remind you that perhaps it's important to notice that every congregation has a sin problem, because every Christian has a sin problem. Some just have it more pronounced, more obvious than others. But let me focus you here that some sins are more shocking than others, to the point that even the worldly people will look and say, "We wouldn't do that." In this context, a man has his father's wife, and it says that would not even be named among the Gentiles. They wouldn't participate in that. That doesn't mean that shocking sins are any more serious than the less shocking sins, but let me remind you, there the way that some members respond is also shocking, because sometimes those who are Christians will respond by gossip. They'll respond by meanness and hatred. They'll respond in some very ungodly ways themselves, to the word of the point where you see a person commit a shocking sin, and then you turn and look and see the way that people respond is also shocking. Well, how do people respond to sin? It's important to go to the Bible and see people's attitude toward it. And the first one is they ignore it as if it had not even happened. Someone commits a sin and then everybody's like, "Well, I guess it happened. I don't know. I'm not keeping up. I'm not keeping up with what's happening." Well, listen to 1 John chapter 1, verse 8 and verse 10. John writes, "If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us." Verse 10, "If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us." The truth is, so many people want to ignore the fact that sin has ever occurred, and to the point where it's like, well, sin was never there to start with. The second way that people react to it is to mock it, to view it in the eyes as if it really was not significant at all, as if, well, that's no big deal. You sin, I sin, we all sin, so what's the big deal about sin? If I take you to Proverbs chapter 14 in verse 9, Solomon would write, "Fools mock at sin, but among the upright there is favor." Or in verses 18 and 19 of chapter 26, "Like a madman who throws firebrands, arrows, and death is a man who deceives his neighbor and says, 'I was only joking.'" Notice, how would you feel if someone were in the front of the auditorium this morning and they had firebrands and they were throwing out in the audience, and you'd say, "Well, I don't like that. That's dangerous. Some of us could be really hurt." Arrows. Someone draws the bow and they start moving and they're pointing across cargo. Is he pointing at me? Will he hit me? He says, "And death is the man who deceives his neighbor and says, 'I was only joking. You know, that's not a big deal. I was just joking. I was just, you know, entertaining myself.'" In Psalm chapter 10, verses 11 through 13, "He has said in his heart, 'God has forgotten. He hides his face. He will never see. Arise, O Lord, O God, lift up your hand. Do not forget the humble. Why do the wicked renounce God? He has said in his heart, you will not require an account.'" This idea, as if it's not significant, God's not even going to pay attention to it. He doesn't see what's going on here. Zephaniah chapter 1, verse 12. And it shall come to pass at that time that I will search Jerusalem with lamps and punish the men who are settled in complacency, who say in their heart, the Lord will not do good, nor will he do evil. There are people in this world who are convinced that God's not going to react one way or another. And so if you bring up sin to them, no, it's no big deal. God's not going to do anything about it. And then there are those who actually defend it. You start talking about sin, and people will say, but now you've got to understand why the sin was committed. And here's where the blame game begins to say, it wasn't really me, but it was this that caused the sin. You remember Genesis chapter 3, verses 12 and 13? The man said, the woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I ate. And the Lord God said to the woman, what is this you have done? The woman said, the serpent deceived me, and I ate. This idea of saying, I want you to understand, I was put in this situation by someone else, and they created the problem, and the sin's really not my fault, it's their fault. Ecclesiastes chapter 1 and verse 9, Solomon said, that which has been is what will be. That which is done is what will be done, and there's no new thing under the sun. We live in a society today when a man shoots someone, the question that is first asked is, what caused him to shoot? If someone does something wrong, we start looking for a cause so that we can assign blame. And then some tolerate sin. In Revelation chapter 2, verse 20, nevertheless, I have a few things against you. Because you allow the woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess, to teach and seduce my servants to commit fornication and to eat things sacrificed to idols. You allow that to be done? You allow open sin to take place and you just tolerate it? Now let me carry you back to 1 Corinthians chapter 5. Their attitude toward the sin that had been committed had the potential to be even worse than the initial sin to start with. In verse 6, your glorying is not good. Do you not know that a little leaven leavens the whole lump? If sin is tolerated, sin is defended, sin is mocked among us or even ignored, here's what happens. I sin, you sin, and we all pretty well say, well, it just really doesn't matter. And so someone else comes along and they feel like, hey, I can sin too, with no consequences whatsoever. The Corinthians had a problem that for them, sin was not a big deal. Sin was something to just really to sneer at it. In fact, they became puffed up about it. What they were instructed to do, they were commanded to do, was to withdraw from the brother in order to save his soul. Look with me at verse 5 and then verses 9 through 11. Deliver such a one to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, that the spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. Notice, you're doing this to save the spirit of that man. Verse 9, I wrote unto you in my epistle not to keep company with fornicators. That's what the person had been practicing. Yet I certainly did not mean with the fornicators of this world or with the covetous or extortioners, idolaters, Since then you would need to go out of the world. But now I've written to you not to keep company with anyone named a brother who is a fornicator or a covetous, idolater, a reviler, a drunkard, or an extortioner. No, not even to eat with such a person. Paul is trying to get them to understand sin is serious and you've got to take care of it. According to 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 6, when they complied with Paul's command, the outcome was successful. Here's a man you deliver to Satan for the destruction of the flesh that you may be able to save the spirit. Look at chapter 2 and verse 6. The punishment which was inflicted by the majority is sufficient for such a man. It worked. You do what God said, the way God said to do it, for the reason that God told you, and it works. Here's the man now who, because the majority had done what Paul had told them to do, had brought about this man's repentance. You remember what I talked about earlier? About the steps you begin first, there's sin that occurs. Then there must be a rebuke that takes place that says, here's the sin that you committed. We can't tolerate it. God will not permit it. Then repentance takes place. That's what takes place here. But now another problem arises. A full pendulum swing on the other side now. It appears that they do not want to forgive the man who had committed this grievous sin. Look with me at verses 7 through 11. So that on the contrary, you ought rather to forgive and comfort him, lest perhaps such a one should be swallowed up with too much sorrow. Therefore, I urge you to reaffirm your love to him. For to this end I also wrote that I might put you to the test, whether you are obedient in all things. Now to whom you forgive anything, I also forgive. For if indeed I have forgiven anything, I have forgiven that one for your sakes in the presence of Christ. Now listen carefully to verse 11. Lest Satan should take advantage of us, for we're not ignorant of his devices. Here's what Paul is telling them. Yes, you have withdrawn from this man. Yes, he has repented. And now the pendulum has swung where you're not ready to forgive him. And Paul says, I'm going to put you to the test. Look at that in verse 9. I might put you to the test whether you're obedient in all things. Did it require them withdrawing to be obedient? Yes, it did. Did it require them to forgive in order to be obedient? And yes, it did. He said, I want to see if you're obedient in all things, not just in part of it. Now, for a few minutes, let's talk about the prescription. At the root of both problems and both extremes is a lack of love. And you might ask, how is that a lack of love? And the first part is, some did not love the sinner enough to rebuke him for his sins, but just let him perish. I hate to say this, folks, but sometimes there is the attitude on the part of some of us, if someone sins, just let him sin. If that's what he wants to do, let him go on to hell. And if that's our attitude, we're no worse than the sinner because we've sinned ourselves. What we're saying is, I don't love you enough to correct you. I don't love you enough to try to get you to turn around so that your soul can be saved. If we are ignoring sin, we are mocking sin, we are defending sin, or we are tolerating sin, we are not acting out of love. But the other end of the spectrum, some did not love the penitent man enough to forgive him following his repentance. Their idea was, I don't really care for him. And because of that, I'm not going to forgive him. Now, why do people struggle with forgiveness? And what is the biblical solution to it? Well, I have some points I want to make. And if you question any of these, Brother Joe made the point at the announcements this morning. If you question anything we're trying to do, please, let's talk about it. Let's open the scriptures. Let's see what it says. And let's make sure that we're doing what God says, not what we think. Number one, too often we fail to understand that all sin is ultimately against God. Too often we have the idea that the sin is against me. Now, it's possible that you may have sin against both, but all sin is ultimately against God. Let me give you two proofs of that. Psalm 51 is one of David's penitential psalms, where David expresses his sorrow for the sin which he has committed with Bathsheba. He was truly humbled by the mistake that he had made. And here's what he said in verse 4, "Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, that you may be found just when you judge," or when you speak, "and blameless when you judge." Did David sin against Bathsheba when he humbled her? He did. Did David sin against Uriah when he put Uriah at the front of the battle and then withdrew, had them to withdraw from him, and he lost his life? Yes, he did. But ultimately, the sin was against God because it was a violation of his will. In Genesis chapter 39, verse 9, you have Joseph being tempted and pursued by Mrs. Potiphar. And here's what he says to her: "There's no one greater in this house than I, nor has he kept back anything from me but you, because you are his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God?" Had Joseph complied with her wishes, he would have sinned against his master Potiphar. But ultimately, the sin would have been against God. And you know, here's where our problem is. We want to put ourselves up here on a perch as if we're the one looking down and we're the one determines whether or not forgiveness can take place. We are putting ourselves in the place of God. If God forgives, who are we to say no? Number two, too often we forget that we also are sinners in need of forgiveness. In the book of Romans, Paul is trying to address the Jewish mindset that is saying, "I am in this position to be an instructor of those who are blind," referring to the Gentiles. And they viewed themselves as looking down on Gentiles because of that. And Paul's response is, after he got through with presenting the full case, he said, "What then? Are we better than they? Not at all, for we have previously charged that both Jews and Greeks, that they're all under sin. As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one." Here's an important aspect to this. For each of us, can I look at somebody else and say, "Well, I've never had to be forgiven of anything"? You really need forgiveness. I never really did. You're only deluding yourself if that's what you're thinking. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, the brethren at Corinth should have really known better. "Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. That's a bad list of folks. And such were some of you. Such were some of you. But you were washed. You were sanctified. You were justified in the name of our Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. The refusal to forgive on our part is to look and say, I forgot that I was a sinner too. There's a key passage in my mind, and I want to ask that you turn to this one. You may have been following along on screen, but this is one I'm going to ask that you turn to in your Bibles. I will have it on the screen, but I believe this one captures the full spectrum of what is involved in real forgiveness. Matthew 18, verse 15. Jesus said, moreover, if your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he hears you, you have gained your brother. But if he will not hear, take with you one or two more, that in the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word may be established. And if he refuses to hear them, tell it to the church. But if he refuses to hear even the church, let him be to you like a heathen and a tax collector. Here's a case where you have individual, direct to direct sin on the part of one toward another. And as I mentioned earlier, you have sin, you have rebuke. That's what he means here when you show him his fault between you and him alone. If he hears you, you've gained your brother. In that case, there's only three people involved. You, the person who sinned, and God. Again, I remind you, because sin, all sin is ultimately against God. And then if that sin does not, repentance does not take place for that sin, here he has suggested what he taught the Corinthians is you withdraw from him. But now if you'll drop down with me to verse 21. And then Peter came to him and said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Up to seven times? Jesus said to him, I do not say to you up to seven times, but up to 70 times seven. And then he's going to explain what that would really mean. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. And when he had begun to settle accounts, one was brought to him that owed him 10,000 talents. But as he was not able to pay, his master commanded that he be sold, that his wife and his children and all that he had, and that payment be made. The servant therefore fell down before him, saying, Master, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. Then the master of that servant was moved with compassion, released him, and forgave him that debt. But the servant went out and found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. And he laid his hands on him and he took him by the throat, saying, pay me what you owe. So his fellow servant fell down at his feet and begged him, saying, have patience with me and I will pay you all. And he would not, but went and threw him in prison till he should pay all that debt. So when his servants saw what had been done, they were very grieved, and they came and told their master all that had been done. And then the master, after he had called him, said to him, you wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you begged me. Should you not also have had compassion on your fellow servant, just as I had pity on you? And his master was angry and delivered him to the torturers until he should pay all that was due him. Now here's the key verse. So my heavenly Father also will do to you if each of you from his heart does not forgive his brother his trespasses. Every one of you have to learn to forgive your brother his trespasses. That's the lesson. You saw the context. Peter's question, how often should I do this? Up to seven times? No, not seven times. 70 times seven. But now I can hear the words reverberating. But has that person truly repented? Did he really repent? You and I cannot know what's in a man's heart. I can't look at you and say, I know what he's thinking. I know what they're thinking. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 said, who knows the things of a man, save the spirit of the man which is in him? Well, how do I know whether or not a man's really repented? If he brings forth fruit worthy of repentance. Matthew chapter 3 verse 8, therefore bear fruits worthy of repentance. I can tell you that someone may come forward this morning and sit on the front pew and say, I want you to know I'm sorry for what I've done. I'm repenting of my sins. I can walk in this pulpit right after that and tell you what the person has said. We can have a prayer for them. And you say, well, I don't know if he really repented or not. Sometimes we've had people do that and they never come back to services again. You've seen that. I've seen that. On the other hand, you've had people who have tried their best to make amends. And people say, I don't know whether or not he's real or genuine or not. Don't be ignorant of the devil's devices. The devil wants us to play the blame game. That's not my fault. Somebody else is responsible for it. He made me do this. She made me do that. Don't let the devil win. The devil also wants us to doubt the sincerity of others. Let me give you a really good illustration of this. You remember Acts chapter 9, right after Paul became a Christian? It says, and when Saul had come to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, but they were all afraid of him and did not believe that he was a disciple. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles, and he declared to them how he had seen the Lord on the road, and he'd spoken to him, and how he preached boldly in Damascus in the name of Jesus. And so he was with them in Jerusalem, coming in and going out. Folks, it's easy for us to let the devil sow the seeds of doubt in our hearts and say, I just don't know. Is he genuine or not? Is he real or not? The devil wants to disrupt the fellowship of the church. He wants us to be divided so that we can't accomplish anything. The best thing the devil likes is when you do like two dogs, or you throw a piece of meat out there and you watch them fight over that, or you have two cats fighting one. No, that's not the way the Lord intended the church to be. Don't let the devil take advantage of us because we're not ignorant of his devices. And this is just one of the topics about which Paul corrected the church at Corinth. There's many others. But the challenge for us is, will we allow the church to be corrected and me individually be corrected by those same scriptures that were given to the Corinthians? The call that you and I have is not to sin. God doesn't want any of us to sin, but the recognition of the fact is we will. And we learn in 1 John chapter 2, beginning with verse 1, my little children, these things I write unto you that you may not sin. And if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins. He satisfied the law's demands. God wants us not to sin, but we're going to. But what you and I have to do after we realize we have sin is repent of it. And then we have to do the works befitting repentance. What a blessing to be forgiven and to be forgiving. If you need to become a Christian this morning, If you believe in Jesus Christ, repenting of your sins, confessing your faith in him, be baptized, and there the Lord will wash away your sins. Acts 22, verse 16. If you're a child of God needing to come home, needing prayers, we'll pray with you. We're going to sing the song, Kneel at the Cross. Would you come as we stand and sing?
First verse of number 321.
Tony, I want to be the first to commend you for that powerful sermon this morning. Very true. And I would say if any of the other elders were standing up here right now, they would say exactly the same thing. Thank you very much. Thank all of you for being here this morning. We do have a good crowd. We have 187 men present this morning. Those of you that are visiting with us, we want to, on Facebook or watch us on Facebook, I should say, we want to thank you for watching us and and may hope how soon you can come back and be a part of the assembly here. We'd like to welcome those, of course, that are visiting with us today. I know sometimes that sounds like a formality. People, we say that, but that's not true. We thank you for coming. I want you to come back, and we consider it an honor that you chose to be with us this morning. Keep in mind those that were mentioned that are sick and shut in, and do whatever we can to comfort them. Our next service is, of course, this evening at 6 o'clock. As we leave today, I want to encourage from an eldership standpoint you to pray for the congregation here, and pray for the church as a whole as you leave. Proverbs 3, 5 through 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depart on your own understanding. Do not depend on your own understanding. Seek His will in all you do, and He will show you which path to take. Proverbs 3, verses 5. We'll sing this song and be dismissed. May God bless each one of you.
Please bear with me. I've had a hard time this morning with I think it's the pollen coming off of these plastic flowers. But thank you so much for joining with us in the song service this morning.
It may be in the valley.
Together. Almighty and loving Heavenly Father, we come before Thy throne of grace through this avenue of prayer that You have given us to talk to You. Father, we give You praise, honor, and glory to Thy high and holy name, for Thou art the only true and living God. Father, we pray that our worship today has been acceptable to You and that we have done everything according to Thy will. Father, we ask Thy blessings upon us and pray that Thou forgive us our sins. Pray that Thou will be with our elders as they make decisions for the congregations. Father, be with our deacons as well as they carry out jobs that they are assigned. And be with each of us that we may do what we can to help proclaim Thy word. Father, be with us on through life's journey and keep us on that straight and narrow pathway. This we ask in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.